Good evening. I'm Steve Krofft. Tonight, the subject is comedy, as seen from the vantage points of three stars who have appeared on West 57th over the last season. Their backgrounds are as varied as their styles. For Billy Crystal, it was stand-up comedy. For Chevy Chase, it was writing for other comedians like the Smothers Brothers. And for Tom Hanks, it was doing Shakespeare in Cleveland. When we decided to profile Hanks, all of our background research told us that he was intensely private, and so we wanted to interview him someplace where we could get a good sense of who this guy really is, a place perhaps where Hanks, an avid baseball fan, might play ball with us, to borrow a sports analogy. So we called the Los Angeles Dodgers and asked a favor. Hey, Tom Hanks, no problem. When you first started, when you were struggling in New York, did you think, I want to go to Hollywood and be a big movie star live at the beach?
No.
Did you ever think it was going to happen?
No clue.
You didn't fantasize about it?
No, not at all. This is not what I'm prone to do.
What Tom Hanks is prone to do is to knock down any suggestion that he's some kind of hotshot movie star celebrity, in spite of the fact that he has consistently delivered hits. Splash, $60 million. Bachelor Party, $40 million. Nothing in Common, $32 million. And last year's $115 million blockbuster, Big. With 14 films in 6 years, Tom Hanks is tracking the only professional goal he's ever set for himself, regular work. Forget about all the hype, Hanks says he's in it for the long haul. And like any major leaguer, he looks for one hit out of three.
317, 306, oh, all right, thank you. Not bad, they'll get me signed up next year.
It's not uncommon for major stars to turn up for interviews with an expensive car, a publicist, and a hairdresser. That's the publicist behind home plate. The hairdresser holding down right field is the one who arrived in the expensive car. Hanks drives his own VW.
So anyway, what is it that you like most about success?
Being able to come into Dodger Stadium by myself. The ability to have people want to work with me is nice, you know? I get to do it again.
Has it changed the way people respond to you?
Strangers, yes. My family, not at all. Then she'll just say I'm loud.
Check out the talent. I'm back. Remember me?
Welcome back, Mr. Ben.
If you want to know what Tom Hanks is really like, a friend says, look at his movies. It's all there in bits and pieces. His screen persona combines the glibness of youth with the sarcasm of an adult. Brash, witty, a bit aloof. But to say that's Tom Hanks belies both his ambition and his talent as an actor.
Who did this? This is adorable, Brian. That was great. Who locked the door? Was it you?
It's a joke.
I knew that I was funny, you know, ever since I was a kid, probably, because I figured out a long time ago that the world is probably broken up into two different groups, you know, one that is funny and one that is not, and I figured I was in the funny camp. And I thought that I honestly, you know, I knew what would be funnier given a choice between a way to say a line or make a move or something like that. I could probably figure that out. But my desire was not to be funny, not to get laughs, but to play the role well and to play the role honestly.
Do you consider yourself a serious actor?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes. By all means. I think I'm very serious.
But you'd like to do the big, important roles that De Niro does?
Everybody would like to.
In fact, Hanks is already getting De Niro roles. De Niro was supposed to play Josh Baskin in Big, the 12-year-old trapped in a grown man's body. Now, it's impossible to imagine anyone except Hanks in that role.
We don't have to keep reminding the audience that he's a 12-year-old boy. He has something in him that has that going for him to begin with.
Penny Marshall directed Hanks in Big. She thinks he can play anything.
Well, he's handsome. He's cute. He does have one side that's better than the other side, but he'll tell you that. Leading man, goofy guy. Leading man, goofy guy.
Are you goofy?
No, I'm Pluto. sometimes I'm downright goofy. Goofy can be a real, descriptive word sometimes. Something just cracks you up because it looks goofy.
We've known each other for a while now. I think it's safe for me to say, but are you aware of your drooling problem?
In his latest film, Tom Hanks plays both leading man and goofy guy to a dog.
I guess you have to be a dog.
For his fans, Turner and Hooch is vintage Hanks, and 180 degrees from last year's punchline, when for the first time, the actor played a role that was not entirely sympathetic.
I don't really know what's fun anymore, so if you people could help me out, just laugh any time that you feel anything funny, just feel.
He has contradictions in his soul. I think you see it in all the work that he does. He's a light comedian, but he's also very vulnerable, and even when he's cutting, he's very vulnerable on the inside.
David Seltzer wrote and directed Punchline. In it, Hanks plays a driven, frustrated, self-absorbed stand-up comic named Stephen Gold. Paired with Sally Field, it is the darkest, most complex role of his career.
How's the house?
Tom Hanks has what Jack Lemmon has. And I think Tom Hanks to this generation is what Jack Lemmon was to his. He's a master of light comedy, and he's also somebody who can break your heart.
This scares me. Stop it.
Don't be scared, because I'm Funny Steve. With a lampshade on his head. Who's singing and dancing for your entertainment his own rendition of Singing in the Rain. La, 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 la.
Sally Field said that there is a side to your personality that nobody sees. A sad side, a dark side. And it's what makes you compelling on the screen. Is she right?
Certainly. You could say that about anybody. That, you know, there's going to be compromises and failures things in a person's past that is going to make him periodically sit down and take stock. I've certainly had that in my time. As Shakespeare said, who I know personally because I once worked with him, that we have to hold the mirror up to nature. And the lives we lead are not all sad, and they're not all rosy, and they're not all fair. That you have to include in that the more horrible aspects of this world, the more cruel aspects, the more unfair.
There are a lot of people right now that are comparing you to the great screen legends. Jackie Gleason said the verdict on Tom Hanks is he's got it. What is it, do you think?
I couldn't even begin. I'm not trying to short the question or anything, but I honestly don't know. Because if I did that, that would remove my emotional involvement in it and make it an intellectual pursuit. And I don't think it's an intellectual pursuit. If it wasn't an intellectual pursuit, intellectuals could do it. It's a stumbling around in the dark for an awful long time until you come out and on the other end. And there are some times that I think probably in every role it's been close to 50-50 or 60-40 between stuff that I made up and stuff that I am.
Hanks is trying hard these days to keep track of who he is, but it's not always easy. Usually, he finds his celebrity annoying. Sometimes, as in the case with a star-struck teenager behind a frozen yogurt counter, he finds it amusing.
She stood behind the counter. Two yogurts, please. Two yogurts. She couldn't move. He said, look, the yogurt cups are behind. Just turn around. That's it. Get the cup. Now go over to the yogurt machine. We want vanilla. She go over. Okay, now on one of them, we'd like cookie crumbs. Cookie crumbs. Cookie. She never said a word through the entire thing. We paid her, got our change and the whole bit. And all the time she was just there like that.
So that happens a lot?
More often than is really comfortable. You know, and I understand, because, you know, I remember being seeing Robert Stack at the airport. And,
Robert Stack?
Long time ago, yeah. I was at LAX, and Robert Stack was getting his luggage out of something. I said, wow, there's Robert Stack! So I do the same thing.
I frankly believe that once an actor's modesty goes, his humility goes, it's very difficult for him to reach the soft parts of himself. And I think Tom's brilliance comes out of the fact that he doesn't overestimate himself.
Who here is in the audience? Punchline, punchline for the very first time. Anybody for the very first time? Everybody's been here before?
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Sometimes we'd rap late at night in New York and we'd have to get a bunch of people into a station wagon. Tom would always go in the back of the station wagon where all the equipment was, and he'd be sort of sprawled out on all these boxes and cables because he felt everybody else was doing the really hard work and they should sit in the seats.
Sooner or later, you're going to have to realize that you've got a monster career on your hands. And yet you continue to defer. I get the sense that if you're working with Sally Field or you're working with Jackie Gleason, that these people in your mind are still way above where you are.
Sure, yeah. You know, these people do the same thing, you know? It's an ensemble thing we do that requires everybody's different personality and expertise and theory in order to make work. You know, there hasn't been a director or there's been people that I didn't like personally, certainly. There's people that I didn't get along with. But there's never been anybody that didn't learn something new from. And you hope that that's the way it's always going to be, because I think that as soon as you stop paying attention to the differences of everybody, you just become a jaded individual, and all you do is sit there and say, yeah, well, pal, I don't do it that way. You know, I've never heard anybody say that. None of the immortals, none of the greats.
One of the things about you as an actor, you're very likable on the screen. And I think everybody wants to get to know you. They want to know more about Tom Hanks because he's this great guy. Does that scare you a little bit?
No. What it would scare me is if they, you know, they demanded to get to know me or get to hang out with me or something like that. That would be a bit much.
What are the questions that you least like to be asked?
Why? Does that mean you're going to ask him?
No.
What do you look for in a girl? The question I ask more than anything else is, so what's your new movie about? That's what I hate more than anything else. I was in an elevator in Chicago and making Nothing in Common. It was very, very late at night, and had worked all day long, and I was going up the elevator, and people got in on the ground floor and were going up, and they were going up to their room after having been out to dinner or something. Had a few drinks, obviously, these people did. And so I get in there, and I'm beat, and I'm tired, and I got gunk on my face, and I can't wait to take a shower and go to bed. And the lady says, oh, you're Tom Hanks, aren't you? I said, yes, ma'am. Oh, well, what are you doing in Chicago? Well, I'm working on a film. Oh. What's it called? It's called Nothing in Common. Oh. What's it about? I said, look, lady, we're not going up enough floors in order to be able to tell you what it's about, all right? Go see the, you know, I had to snap at this lady. That's the question I hate. Let me sum up in three words. It's about life, death, drama, relationships, and living. What are you going to do?
Do you have patience for that kind of thing?
Oh, yeah, I have a certain amount. Other times I don't. And most people are very respectful and very decent. I must say, most people are very, very polite. Very, very polite. That's an out.
That's probably a hit.
No way. Maybe like a banjo single.
There is a certain sense of serendipity about you and about your on-screen persona that if it didn't really work out, you know, that's no big deal. Don't take me too seriously. And by the way, if my next three films bomb, I'm going to go down to the beach or I'm going to go back to Cleveland and do Shakespeare. Or is that really you?
No, I don't think so. I'm just as competitive as somebody else is, but I think I can rein in the more unpleasant aspects of that competitiveness and keep it to myself. I think very highly of myself and my work, but I think I'm going to keep that. I'm not going to tell anybody about that because you start sounding like a jerk. You just swing away. I mean, you know, that's all you do.
Good hit. Good hit.
There we go. That was a double.